It's all nice to see you here this afternoon. Thank you for joining us. And it's an immense pleasure for me once again to sit with you and speak with you about your work. I don't know, we'll show at the end all of the films of Helena's plus her top 10 selections so you can see once again what's on offer at the festival and the days and times they'll be playing. But there are some marvelous, marvelous selections as well in your top 10 curation. I've seen them all and it's absolutely fascinating group of films. So thank you for that. I want to just read a little exchange that you and I had when we met in 2011 in Finland, in Helsinki, when I interviewed about you about your film Katka. And you said, "I often wonder how audiences from other countries can accept or come to my films, how they can connect with our daily realities in Czech Republic, the intricate ways these films are related to this nation and to this culture. It always somehow is surprising to me." And I replied by saying, "It's a rare and wonderful thing to witness this kind of commitment, this kind of obligation on the part of one human being to another." And that for me is... Helena will be speaking in Czech this afternoon. So that for me, this commitment that you make to your protagonists and they in turn make to you, I kind of want this talk to be sort of unpacking, if you will, of how these relationships develop, their rules, their limitations, etc. So I want to start by talking about when you first got out of film school and made your first short film, which turned into a longer film eventually. But what was it about this commitment to what I'll call longitudinal filmmaking, meaning your commitment to knowing that you might want to follow certain people for decades?
So thank you for coming. Thank you for your interesting question. I will probably speak Czech, and it will be translated because for me it's better if it's more precise that I can with my limited English. Yes. So ty začátky. V těch začátcích jsem si nebyla úplně jistá, ale ta moje metoda začala být úplně jasná v roce 80 při startu manželských etid, kdy jsem se rozhodla, že budu touhle metodou pracovat.
In the very early days, I wasn't really sure about this method, but it became clear in 1980 when I first started out on marriage stories and I decided to use this method.
Měli jsme točit několik manželských párů od momentu svatby 6 let, to byl úkol.
The assignment was to film with six couples from the day of their wedding for the next 6 years. That was the assignment.
Ty páry jsme potkali náhodou na matrice a vůbec jsme netušili, co z toho bude.
These couples were randomly selected at the registry office and we had no idea what was going to happen.
Je to sázka na nejistotu a víra v to, že každý lidský život je zajímavý.
you never know what's going to happen, so you just hope something is going to happen, and you have to believe that every human life is interesting.
Naši hrdinové musí být pravdiví, autentičtí a opravdoví.
The protagonists have to be authentic, they have to be honest, they have to be truthful.
A musí vědět, že já jsem čestná holka a nikdy nebudu našeho natáčení nějak zneužívat.
And they also need to know that I am being honest to them and that I'm never going to abuse our relationship and the situation of filming.
A dělám všechno pro to, aby mi věřili a myslím, že se to snad daří, protože zatím všechny ty vztahy, které jsem navázala před mnoha lety, zatím trvají.
And I do everything for them to be able to trust me, and I think so far I've succeeded because all of these relationships that I started all those years ago, they are still here with me.
A to je vlastně pro mě vyznamenání.
So that's in a sense an honor for me.
So you are working on several different stories simultaneously. Could you explain, and you're working, you have sort of camera crews and cameramen and sound men on call, you know, as you're corresponding with your protagonists in their daily lives, they're calling you, this is happening, this is happening, oh Helena, this happened in a very open way, you know, and but you have to sort of know how to pick and choose. Like, you can't go running, right, every second that something happens. So I know you don't start to edit until everything is shot, but dramaturgically, from experience, is it a sense, is it an intuition, or what are your rubrics, or what are your rules, in a way, for you and your camera crew to know when to step in, when it's important, when it's going to be a waste of time, essentially?
Takže mám několik kameramanů, několik zvukařů, kteří jsou zvyklí na moji práci, s těma pravidelně pracuju. A
I have several cinematographers and several sound recordists, people who know my way of working, and I've worked with them regularly, so I have several of them.
A v časozběrném filmu je takový zajímavý jev, že když začínáte, netušíte, o čem ten příběh bude.
And it's interesting about time-lapse documentary is that when you start out making a film, you have no idea what the story is going to be, where it's going to go.
A ten příběh se teprve v průběhu času vyvíjí. Ale je třeba točit co nejvíce a teprve ve střižně vznikne ten tvar.
So the story takes shape over time, and it's important to shoot as much as possible, and only in the editing room you actually emerge with the shape of the film, with the form.
Protože teprve při tom konečném střihu vlastně poznáváte, které linky toho příběhu jsou důležité a které třeba ne a které je možné vynechat.
Because it is only in the process of editing and in the final cut that you realize what storylines are important and which are perhaps less so and which can be left out.
Mm-hmm. A jinak s těmi mými hrdiny jsem v takovém průběžném kontaktu i mimo natáčení, voláme si, navštěvujeme si a je to, nemá to nějakou pevnou strukturu, je to, celé to moje činění je takový trochu chaotický jako život sám.
And as for my protagonists, I keep in touch with them throughout outside of production as well, outside of shooting. We visit, we call each other, and it's not very structured or organized. It's very chaotic, mm-hmm. like life.
A ještě teda důležitá věc k tomu ukončení příběhu, to je vždycky dáno producentskými dojednáními, když získáme financování filmu, tak víme přesně, kdy ten film musí být hotov. Čili vlastně vím přesně, kdy musím ten film dodělat.
And as for the moment to finish the film, it's actually simple because when you get funding for a documentary, when you sign a contract for production, you have a deadline, so I know exactly when the film will have to wrap up.
Okay. Also too, you know, Czech Republic and that whole block of countries has gone through extraordinary socio-political, economic changes. Every decade is like a new decade, and because you are following people for so long a time, we can see the immediacy of how these larger issues are affecting them. And I mean, you yourself also have been known to be a political person. Very briefly, I appreciate the fact that you were the Minister of Culture for 10 days before you resigned.
So,
18 days.
18. It's a difference.
Yes, but nonetheless, you know, your films have this very strong through line of where we are in time and place. And so it's not just these sort of little stories in a bubble. I mean, from Renee's story to Katka's story to a marriage story, we see how these outside forces are affecting these families. I'd like to show this series of clips we have. I don't know how many of you went and saw Marriage Story, but you'll get a little taste here. We have some clips to show you from the film, just so you can see the jumps in time. So if we can play that clip now, that would be great.
Teď budou ty klipy, nebo mám něco odpovědět? No, teď... Ano, jasně.
Nech je celý váš další život naplněn vzájemnou důvěrou. Ať je naplněn společným štěstím. Ať je naplněn vaší velkou, obapolnou láskou.
A nyní se vás táži, pane Václave Strnade, dneska dobrovolně vstupujete do manželství se zde přítomnou stečnou Ivanou Cíkorovou.
Ano.
Děkuji vám. Táži se i vás, stečnou Ivanou Cíkorová, zda dobrovolně vstupujete do manželství se zde přítomným panem Václavem Strnadem.
Ano.
Děkuji.
Skoro 19 a ten se rodí úplně první. Druhý byl Martin, toho jste ještě zachytili, tomu bude 15.
Kde si ty ruce z kapec, člověče?
Terka, Tereza 12 let a kousek.
A já.
To je Terezy úplně nakonec. Pak je Tomáš, tomu je kolik?
6.
6 a ten půjde za školy po prázdninách. A tady to je Vašík. A tomu je kolik je ti? 3. Vy. Ještě kečupu, si babka čuká.
Ještě, že to stalo snad bude vystřežené.
A teď, když vidíme, že to prostě nemůžeme, tak je to hrozný. Teď já třeba vůbec sem nebo chodit. Mám ho jít někam hledat, kam? Kam ho mám jít hledat? Jak ho mám hledat? Dokonce si Ivana i spolikala prášky kvůli něm.
Fakt je to, že když jsem ty prášky snědla, že mi bylo strašně dobře. Že ze mě všechno odešlo. Já neměla v hlavě jedinou starost, jedinou bolest, jedinou prostě myšlenku na někoho. Já jsem byla strašně svobodná. A já prostě nejsem.
Tak vždycky mě zajímal kontrast malých a velkých dějin.
I've always been fascinated with the contrast of big and small history.
Protože když jsem studovala na FAMU a dívala jsem se na různé historické dokumenty, tak tam většinou byly ty velké dějiny. A já jsem si říkala, jak v té době žili normální lidi.
When I was a student at the Czech National Film School at FAMU, they showed us films on historical themes, but it was always the big history, the big historical events. And mm-hmm. I was always wondering, actually, how did people live, the ordinary small people, what was their life like?
Takže tohle téma jsem vlastně chtěla udělat mým hlavním tématem. Takže můj zájem je Česká republika, normální, běžní lidi.
So this was what I wanted to pursue in my career. This was my main theme. My themes are the Czech Republic and the lives of ordinary little people.
A nebo lidi s nějakým problémem, který řeší třeba drogy nebo kriminální aktivity.
Or people who have an issue such as, for example, drug addiction or criminal activities, or you know, issues that people can have. Mm-hmm.
Ale to všechno se odehrává právě zároveň paralelně probíhají ty velké dějiny, takže jsem se snažila to nějak do těch filmů dostat.
But of course these lives are set in a certain context in parallel with the big history which mm-hmm. goes on. And I always try to put that in my film as well.
A vždycky to vzniklo z nějakého nápadu, že ve filmu René se René díval na volbu prezidenta a tak jsem se rozhodla potom do jeho příběhu dostat všechny volby prezidenta, který probíhaly v době natáčení.
And you can do it in different ways. For example, with René, I had the idea, I saw him watching the presidential election, and I thought that actually I could get the big history in the film by including all the presidential elections that took place while mm-hmm. I was shooting.
Mm-hmm. A poté, co film René byl dokončen, tak my pokračujeme dál a už tam máme natočené další dvě prezidentské volby.
And René was finished, but we continued shooting. We showed the film, we finished the film 10 years ago, but we continued shooting, and since then we've had two more presidential elections there in the film.
A ty prezidenti jsou teda čím dál horší, a René naopak bych řekla, že se vylepšuje.
And while the presidents keep getting worse, René on the other hand keeps getting better.
Maybe there's a corollary there, who knows? Speaking of René, this is far from an ordinary person, really. I think in many ways this character of who he is, it's not only what he represents, but he himself is a person fit to be a movie star. I mean, I think the And I mean, it's a nice, you know, you had a certain relationship with Vaclav and Ivana, who do go through quite extreme changes, not only in their relationship and in their marriage, but personally, you know, dealing with aging in a culture that they're no longer, you know, they don't understand what's happening with a couple of their kids. It's like you can see the generation gap is getting wider and wider as time is going on. But in terms of this inspiration, when you saw First Love by Kieslowski and from 1974, and you know, learning that he stopped shooting with this couple that he actually did want to follow also for a very long time, but felt very conflicted about that. Thinking that his presence, the camera coming in and out of their lives, would somehow be too disruptive and would change their lives, in fact, and he didn't want that responsibility. So when you meet someone like Katka, someone like Renee Mallory, what are your sort of personal laws of nature, if you will, with these relationships? How do you negotiate that line between a friendship, which you definitely have with these people, of course, there's a personal connection, but if you can talk a little bit about your own guidelines in dealing, because you ultimately you are the filmmaker that's going to make a distilled, as Ordois used, a distilled image of their lives while they themselves are living their lives.
Tak to je prostě úplně zásadní téma dokumentu, je odpovědnost k protagonistům. A mě teda hrozně zaujalo právě ten postoj Krištofa Kieslowského, že on po roce natáčení vzdal ten časozběrný projekt, protože se bál, že by ovlivňoval jejich životy.
Obviously, responsibility is a key issue of documentary filmmaking, your responsibility towards your protagonists. And it's fascinating that Kieslowski gave up his documentary project after 1 year because he was worried about, and he didn't want to be responsible for influencing his protagonists' lives.
Ale já jsem se tohle dozvěděla vlastně o něco později a přitom ve stejné době jako on jsem vlastně dělala velmi stejný typ filmu. To byl film Zázrak, který je tu taky uveden.
But I only learned he gave up sometime later, while I was already engaged in my project Miracle, that is also showing in my retrospective.
A, takže mě to vlastně zase znovu intenzivně připomnělo toto zásadní téma dokumentu. Točíme o živých, autentických lidech a chceme, aby ty filmy byly co nejzajímavější, ale zároveň těm lidem nesmíme ublížit.
But this really again brought into focus this theme for me very sharply, because you're making a film about living people and you want to make your film as interesting as possible, but you must never hurt the people you're making the film with.
A takže jsem si říkala, jestli Krištof, když se na mě dívá z nebe, jestli si myslí, že jsem se nějak tomuhle úkolu zpronevěřila, tak jsem na něj myslela. A musím říct, že já sama jsem dělala vždycky všechno pro to, aby to bylo v pořádku, ten vztah.
So I keep thinking about Kieslowski, who's looking at us from above, and I was wondering whether he would say that I lived up to this key principle, but I can only say that I've always done my best to never hurt anybody, to go by this rule.
A vím, že je to vlastně hrozně těžký vztah, protože já jsem teda ta režisérka a oni jsou ti lidé před kamerou, ale oni zároveň vědí, že jsme tím projektem spojeni, že já to vnímám jako naše společné dílo. A doufám, že oni taky.
And this is very difficult, this relationship, because on the one hand, you're the director, you call the shots, and they're in front of the camera. But I always want them to know that we are in this project together. In some sense, this film is our joint work, and that's the way I see it, and I hope they feel it also.
Mm-hmm. Nikdy je nenutím k něčemu, co nechtějí říct, i když vím, že by to bylo třeba zajímavý.
I never, for example, make them say things they wouldn't want to say, even if I know that it would be very interesting for the film.
Vždycky jim před dokončením film ukážu a akceptuju jejich připomínky.
I always show them the final cut before I finish the film, and I accept their comments.
A musím říct, že většinou ti lidé se k těm filmům o sobě staví pozitivně, což mě samozřejmě ohromně těší a doufám teda, že tím pádem je potvrzeno, že ten vztah je OK.
And I have to say that most of the time they accept the films I make about their lives. They accept that, they see it positively, which makes me very happy, and I also think that it proves that our relationship is okay.
Mm-hmm. Například René se na základě toho filmu opakovaně seznamoval s několika ženami, s kterými byl v nějakou dobu ve vztahu. A který ho obdivovali jako romantického desperáta.
Actually, René met several women that he was in a relationship with later based on the film, because they had seen the film and they saw him as a romantic desperado.
Sestoupivší ze stříbrného plátna do života.
He was somebody who had stepped down from the silver screen into their lives.
Nebo hrdinka Mallory, vylečená narkomanka, dělá s tím filmem přednášky pro školy a dělá to velmi aktivně a radostně.
And Mallory, who was a drug addict, but she has freed herself from her addiction. She now travels with the film lecturing for school kids. I think she finds a vocation in this and she does that very actively.
Mm-hmm. That's wonderful to hear. That's a very inspiring film, Mallory. You kept, in the final cut of René, you kept a very interesting scene in the film, which we'd like to show you all, where in the midst of filming, he has a lot of questions. And, you know, I guess maybe he's not so convinced, you know, of the relationship and how solid it is personally, and he challenges you, and I find it very beautiful, actually, that you, I mean, he's in prison again at the time behind bars, but, you know, after we watch this scene, we rarely see you in your films, but once in a while, you do step in. There is an intervention there. Which is something I'd like to discuss more with you, but let's play this scene from René right now about this conversation about your relationship together.
Slibuji na svou čest a svědomí věrnost Československé socialistické republice.
Kolik ti ta amnestie zkrátila dobu ve vězení?
Amnestie to bylo 11 měsíců a 20 dnů. Díky za ně. Budu muset se na nějaký byt. Půjdu to u nějakého známého, nebo já nevím kde. Nevím kam půjdu. Otcem nepůjdu, no a co matkou, tak ne. No, tak nemá cenu je otravovat, nebo tam za nima chodit.
Já fakt nevím, co bych tím měl říct. říct, já bych toho chtěl říct tolik, nebo tolik by jsem to chtěl říct. Já myslím, že lepší bude to říct u kafe někde potom venku, jo. Teď spíš, co bys chtěla slyšet do filmu, by mě zajímalo.
Ten film je tvoje dílo, nevím.
Tvoje dílo, já jsem jenom satyr.
To není pravda, ty témata tam vnášíš ty.
Vnáším tam já témata na tvoje otázky, ale tobě se chci omluvit ještě jednou za to, co se stalo v roce 90 nebo 92. Já už si to nepamatuju, když už je konec toho filmu, tak ať to tam aspoň zazní, aspoň jednou. Myslím, že se ještě někdy uvidíme, kromě natáčení. To záleží na tobě, já sám do toho nepojedu, kdyby to připadalo, abych tak řekl trapný, Víček. Co myslíš ty? Přijmeš pozvání, kdy za to přijde do Prahy jako normální člověk, ne jako kriminální, který zrovna potřebuje pomoct asi. No, jsem rád. Já ne. Třeba. Já nevím. Víš, jak ono to zní takový před kamerou, ještě to zní takový patetický, jo, ale já už jsem si na tebe zvyk. Od 88. roku nebo od kdy mě točíš, to máš 14 let. Za 14 let, jo, 14 let. Za 14 let jsem se s vlastní mámou viděl asi 6krát, jo. Když to s tebou jsem se viděl 10krát tolik, jo, přibližně. Zvík je železná košle. Pamatuješ si na ty opisy, jak jsem ti psal Švobachem? Jsem byl do tebe v té době dokonce asi zamilovaný. To už si ani nepamatuju. Tak teď už to je jedno, teď už tě beru jako člověka, který... Jak jsem se tě zeptal tenkrát v nemocnici, pamatuješ si to? No, nevím, jestli to může být do kamery, nebo nemůže. Jestli mě bereš jenom jako objekt zkoumání, nebo jestli ke mně máš taky nějaký jiný vztah, než jenom jako k objektu, který ho natáčíš. Dokážeš na to odpovědět normálně.
No, co jsem řekla tehdy?
Už si nepamatuju.
Tak, nikdo není jenom objekt zkoumání.
Jasně, ale to musí říct úplně o každým, pardon.
Já to ještě vydržím, když to je nevoda.
Nikdo nebyl nikdy jenom objekt zkoumání.
Aspoň tak děkuju.
No, tak to je taková vypjatá scéna, kde já jsem byla překvapená Reného slovy, že byl do mě zamilovaný, přitom jsem si teda opravdu nevšimla. A uvědomila jsem si, že to je takový strašně zásadní rozhovor, který je vlastně zásadní pro celou mou práci.
This was a really dramatic scene for me, very tense. And René surprised me when he said that he had had a crush on me because I had not seen that. But I realized that this was an absolutely key conversation, not only for this film, but for my work as a whole.
Mm-hmm. A možná, že tenhle problém mají i ostatní hrdinové, ale nedokáží to formulovat. Zatímco René, chytrej člověk, to vlastně takhle vyjádřil a já tu scénu mám pořád před očima.
Perhaps my other protagonists would say the same thing, except they would not articulate it as well as René, who is very intelligent, and he managed to articulate this issue. And I keep seeing this scene in front of my eyes.
A vlastně se snažím udělat všechno pro to, aby oni věděli všichni, že pro mě nejsou jenom objekty filmu, ale že jsou strašně důležitou součástí mýho života, nezávisle na filmu.
And I try to do all I can for them to know that they are not simply an object of study for me, that they are not simply extras or protagonists in my film, that they are an important part of my life outside of filmmaking.
Taková drobnost, před nějakým časem jsem slavila narozeniny a pozvali jsme všechny hrdiny mých filmů. Všichni přišli a strašně krásně se spolu opili a hrozně se skamarádili.
And just a story to illustrate, I celebrated my birthday some time ago, and I invited all of the protagonists of all of my films, and they all came. We all got very happily drunk together, and they all made great friends.
A když jsem pak se dozvídala o těch různých dobrodružstvích v noci a tak, tak jsem si říkala, jo, OK, všechno v pohodě.
And when I later would learn all the adventures of that night, well, I was very happy that it ended well.
Protože já jsem odpadla dřív.
Because I went to sleep earlier. So.
Ah, okay, and they stayed up and partied. Yeah, I mean, I think in documentary circles, this idea of this relationship and its limitations and the way it can also expand is always a question. And I don't really perceive it as a moral or ethical issue so much as just a human one. You know, we have different relationships on different levels at any given time. And despite Rene's weaknesses, if you will, he can't stop committing crimes in his early life, you know, he can't find a way into the system, you know? He's an outlaw, pure and simple. And he lives his life as such, and because of that, and because of where we are in time and place, he gets thrown in prison over and over and over again. But with Katka, we come upon a very fragile situation and a very fragile person who you filmed with through horrendous circumstances with her. And I'm curious to know what other things cropped up for you as you got personally involved with this young, beautiful girl who we see before our eyes deteriorate, and her life is just a shambles. Can you talk a little bit about, both on camera and off camera, what kind of interventions and things that occurred to sort of move yourself along in thinking, okay, it's okay to keep filming with her?
No tak Katka je asi eticky nejtěžší film. Musím říct, že začátek byl v léčebně, kde záměr byl sledovat terapeutku a dvě dívky, její pacientky, které se dostávají z drog. To byl start projektu.
Katka was ethically the hardest film I ever made. At the start, the idea was that we were observing two girls and a therapist, two mm-hmm. girls struggling with drug addiction and trying to get rid of it.
A pak ta terapeutka jako řekla, že už dál to natáčení nesedí a jedna z klientek po vyléčení odešla do Ameriky, takže zůstala Katka.
And eventually the therapist no longer wanted to go on with the shoot, and the other girl leaving the institution went to America, so there was only Katka who was left with us.
Ale terapeutka zůstala stále s námi v kontaktu, jako nebylo to ve špatném, jenom nechtěla být před kamerou.
But the therapist continued to be in touch with us. We never parted in a bad way. She just didn't want to continue making the film.
Mm-hmm. A podstata časozběrného filmu je, že se točí to, co se děje, nikoliv to, co si přejete, aby se dělo.
And the essence of time-lapse documentary is that you film what happens, not what you want to happen.
Takže Katka před mýma očima vlastně opakovaně prohrávala ten boj s drogou.
So in front of my eyes, Katka kept losing her battle with drug addiction over and over again.
A naše debaty byly opakovaně stejné, že já jsem jí mluvila do duše, Katko, prosím tě, už něco s sebou udělej opakovaně. Ale netočila jsem to, protože ten film není o mně a o mojí roli terapeutky, ale o Katce. Čili v tom filmu zůstaly jenom asi dvě scény tohoto typu, ale jinak jsem vlastně se snažila, ale není to zachycený.
And I repeatedly talked to Katka, tried to remonstrate with her, tried to see a different way. And we had many of these conversations. In the end, only about two moments like this remained in the film, because I decided the film was not about me and what I do for her. It was about Katka.
Samozřejmě jsem po tom filmu se snesla vlna kritiky, že jsem hyena, která pozoruje cizí neštěstí.
And obviously after the film came out, there was a lot of criticism. People accused me of being a hyena who simply watches somebody's misery.
Ale já jsem se vždycky snažila říct, ale já můžu pro Katku udělat cokoliv, ale nemůžu za ní přestat fetovat. A to je jediný, o co šlo.
But my answer to that always was that no matter what I can do for Katka, there is one thing I can't do. I can't make her stop taking drugs, and that's the one thing she has to do.
Ten film je dneska používaný na školách jako protidrogová osvěta. A s Katkou jsem pořád v kontaktu a naposledy jsem ji viděla asi před týdnem. A bohužel tam není žádný progres.
The film is now actually used in schools as an educational film to discourage people from taking drugs. I still keep in touch with Katka. The last time I saw her was about a week ago, and unfortunately there is no progress in her story.
To nebylo natáčení, to jsme se jenom setkali a já jsem jí dávala nějaký peníze. Taková obvyklá situace.
But it wasn't for shooting with her. It's we just met and I gave her some money, which is a usual situation that has recurred many times.
Ještě k tomu tématu peníze, to bylo taky častý problém, že jsme za to natáčení Katce platili. To je důležité říct, platíme každému takovou symbolickou částku za natáčecí den, úplně každému. A v případě Katky, jako mnoho lidí mi říkalo, tak ty dáváš na drogy, ale já jsem říkala, když ji nedám já, tak bude krást nebo se bude prostituovat, tak aspoň prostě tento problém ji na chvilku vyřešení těmi penězma.
And talking about money, this was also a frequent criticism because we pay our protagonists not very much. It's a symbolic fee for the time we take from their lives that they spend shooting with us. But I was often criticized that I give her money for drugs to feed her drug addiction. And my answer to that is that if she didn't get the money from me, if she didn't make it by filmmaking, she would steal or she would become a prostitute. So perhaps I helped her in that sense to keep her from that for a time.
Let's take a look at the clips we have from Katka.
Thank you. Já či prostě bych fakt co tady toho kopal. Prostě v jakém jsem stavu, to úplně nesnáším. Nenávidím. Mě to prostě ubíjí, opravdu, že... Já bych si nečila prostě perník. Aby mě to vybudilo prostě, aby to mě takhle nespala, neusínala. Tě to hrozný, takhle se bavit s lidma, jako, a usínat, jako. Ta dávka už je tak silná prostě na mě, že já to úplně nemám ráda teď stavit.
Tak to je asi taková jedna z nejhorších, z nejstrašnějších scén. A jenom chci říct, že to byla domluvená schůzka, na kterou Katka přišla v tomhletom stavu. A tak samozřejmě tam je otázka točit nebo netočit. Jak jsme to natočili a tak se mi zdálo, že pokud chceme ukázat, co droga s člověkem dokáže, takže to tam asi má být.
This was actually one of the worst scenes we shot with Katka. We had arranged to meet and she arrived in this state and obviously the question was, do we shoot with her or do we not? Mm-hmm. And we did. And then, of course, if you want to show what a drugs can do to you, so you have to show it.
A potom tam je ještě taková v té další scéně taková zajímavost, že Katka, když ten film byl, že nejdřív byl první část filmu o ní, nebo první film o ní, který byl odvysílán v televizi, jsme pokračovali v natáčení a ona a natočili jsme, jak ona reflektuje reakce diváků po vysílání toho prvního filmu.
And in the next scene we were shooting with Katka reflecting on the responses of people who saw the first film. We had made the first film that was shown on Czech television, mm-hmm. and she talks about people reacting to the first film.
Mm-hmm. A jako na tom zajímavé bylo, že ona říkala, že měla strašně dobrý reakce, že byla do té doby zvyklá, že lidi na ulici se na ní dívají s opovržením, jako na odpad, fetka. A teď se na ní dívali s porozuměním.
And she told us that she actually had very good reactions, that previously people in the street would look at her with disdain, that she was trash because she was a junkie, and after the film people would look at her with understanding.
Hmm. A tak to pro mě bylo vlastně takový jeden z důvodů, proč teda s Katkou pokračovat, protože jsem pořád doufala, že tam nastane ten zlom a nastane prozření.
And this was actually one of the reasons why I continued filming with Katka, because I kept hoping that there will be a turning point, that there will be an epiphany.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's interesting, the selections from this interview that I read at the very beginning of our talk, you know, you had a reply, because my following question to you was, what was Katka's reaction when she saw the finished film?
I saw it. And,
you know, you said, after she saw the film, someone asked her what she thought she had managed to do in her life that she could redeem as something good, something positive. And Katka replied that she had had a child and that she had made this film with Helena. So my next question is, I guess two part. How do you know when you're done? How do you know when you're ready to take all of the footage that you've collected over the years, that's been logged carefully and knowing what you have had and what's occurred over the decades, and you want to move into your edit? Can you talk a little bit about your work with your dramaturgs and your editor, and how that shape takes form? What becomes important to the story? What falls away?
Yes. Tomhle typu práce, časozběrné natáčení, a důležité je, že já těch projektů dělám víc najednou, je mít o každém natáčecím dni přehled.
In this type of work, and I work on several time-lapse projects simultaneously, it's very important to keep track of every single shooting day.
Po každém natáčecím dni se nechá udělat transkript toho, vlastně takový jako zpětný scénář toho natočeného materiálu. A před každým dalším natáčením já se tím předchozím natáčením proberu tím transkriptem.
And after every shoot I have a transcript done. And before I shoot again, I go back to all the transcripts and read through them.
A vlastně mi tak vzniká takový jako zpětný scénář toho projektu.
In this way, I have a kind of retrospective script of the project.
Mm-hmm. A já vím ten termín dokončení, čili asi tak rok před tím dokončením začnu pracovat na tom, že dělám z toho materiálu, si připravuju materiál do střižny, vybírám ty důležité části.
So I know the deadline. I know when the film has to be finished. So about a year before the deadline, I read through this and I start to get the footage I would want to use in the editing room ready for
okay.
that.
Okay. So the deadline is imposed by funders. Is that correct?
Ano, to je nějakýma těma producentskýma dohodama.
Yes, it's usually the production agreement or contract okay. that I have. It's a deadline.
A v případě, že by se něco dělo, čekalo něco strašně důležitého a potřebovali jsme to prodloužit, tak by to hypoteticky šlo, ale většinou se snažíme to dodržet.
Obviously, if there was a hugely important moment in the life of my protagonists, we could continue shooting, but we usually try to comply with the deadlines imposed by producers.
A když se připravím ten materiál pro střižnu, tak na základě toho ve střižně uděláme asi takový já nevím, třeba 4hodinový tvar. A z toho potom se vlastně destiluje ten definitivní tvar, což většinou bývá tak kolem 90 minut.
So it is then, like about a year before the deadline, that I start to get the material ready for the editing room, and we bring this to a rough cut of about 4 hours,
mm-hmm.
and it is from that that we distill the approximately 90 minutes.
A tam je taky čas pro případné dotáčky, kdy už se vlastně dá daleko přesněji říct, co bychom ještě potřebovali, jako jak ten příběh uzavřít.
And this also gives us time for additional shooting in case we need something more to wind up the story, a conclusion.
A potom taková strašně důležitá, teda technická věc, ale důležitá je, když se udělá takový první hrubý střih, tak si dát nějakou dobu pauzu, aby člověk získal nadhled a odstup. Protože v té střižně je naprostá zahlcenost tím materiálem a po nějakém třeba měsíci se na to člověk najednou dívá čerstvým okem.
And another important thing, which is quite technical, is when we have the first rough cut, it's very important to have a break from it, to get some perspective and detachment, because in the editing room you can become very immersed in things, so it's important to give yourself about a month to be able to look at it with fresh eyes.
Right. Well, you know, I mean, there are infinite choices, of course, in putting together a story. And you've chosen to really portray a life lived chronologically. You know, there's no, you know, flashbacks moving forward, moving back. I mean, another filmmaker would say, okay, I really want to really concentrate more on the theme. I have this theme in mind that I want to talk about. And so you would manipulate the footage in a way that would bring forth themes. Instead, you know, again, this longitudinal, you've spent decades of your life together. Can you talk a little bit about that decision of staying in this chronological, sort of linear way where we see the characters emerge from young, middle-aged, adulthood, etc.?
No, já neumím ty filmy dělat jinak než chronologicky.
I can't do films any other way than chronologically.
A možná je to tím, že jsem tak poznamenaná tím, že pro mě, jako já vidím ten lidský život jako takovou nějakou linku, která jde odsud sem, a mám pocit, že všechny příčiny a následky a tak musíme vnímat chronologicky.
Perhaps it's my vision of life as a line going from one place to another, and all the causes and effects can only be seen and understood chronologically.
Ale musím říct, že jsem zkoušela překročit svůj stín a zkoušeli jsme ve střižně nějaký takový způsob třeba se někde zaměřit na jedno téma a dát k sobě, jak to téma je reflektovaný v různý době, ale mám pocit, že to prostě nefungovalo a nebyla jsem s tím spokojená a tak jsem si říkala, že prostě asi to nedokážu, asi to není můj typ uvažování a musím se smířit s tou chronologičností a doufám, že se s tím smíří i diváci.
And actually, I guess I tried to break out of this limitation, and we tried to focus on a specific theme, juxtaposing it, how it is reflected at different time levels, but it didn't work. I wasn't happy with it, and I had to realize that perhaps this is not my way of thinking, and I had to reconcile myself to chronology, and I hope my audience also reconciled themselves to it.
Mm-hmm. Well, you talk about the fact that your responsibility to your protagonists and the responsibility to your spectators has equal weight.
Yes, it's very important. To je strašně důležitý, že já vnímám diváky jako ti, pro který to dělám a snažím se, strašně se snažím vlastně, aby to bylo srozumitelný a aby ten film byl divácky přijatelný, že občas známe takový filmy, které jsou třeba esteticky úžasný, ale diváci je nepřijímají, takže v tomhle směru já vždycky se snažím, aby mít tu odpovědnost i vůči divákům.
I think that's very important because the audience, these are the people I make the film for, and I always try really hard to make the film understandable and clear and watchable, because there are films that are aesthetically amazing, but the audiences just won't accept them or won't watch them. So my responsibility is to make them also accessible and watchable for the audience.
Odpovědnost vůči lidem, kteří věnovali svůj čas tomu, že přišli, sedí tady, teď třeba mě poslouchají, ale když přijdou do kina, tak věnují svůj čas tomu, aby viděli můj film, tak prostě mám pocit, že nesmím zklamat vás, diváky.
I feel this is my responsibility towards the people who have taken the time out of their life to come and, okay, hear me talk now or come and watch my films, and I feel that I cannot let you down.
You mentioned to me that you are shooting with Renee again, that there was a moment in time, of course, where the film ended, and not a very happy ending. I mean, at the end, he basically steals the camera that you've given him to shoot his life and sort of self-film, because this has become, you know, a storytelling tool, you know, to I mean, I've done that before as well, to give a protagonist a small camera and shoot something, shoot when in these intimate moments, you know. But he ends up just disappearing and taking the camera with him. But, you know, flash forward now, several years later, and you're collaborating again.
Yes. Tak na ten konec s tou kamerou, to byl takovej můj nápad. Když jsem věděla, že ten film musím dokončit, René bude opouštět vězení. Několikrát jsme tu situaci předtím točili a vždycky řekla, teď už jděte pryč, teď si jdu žít svoji svobodu a u toho vás nechci. Tak mě napadlo, že by si to mohl sám natočit. A takže to byl takový jako nápad, jak udělat konec s tím, že jsou dvě možnosti, buď něco natočí a udělá si vlastní konec filmu, nebo kameru nevrátí, a tak to bude taky poenta.
That was actually when I had to finish the film and he was leaving jail again, and this was a recurring scene that we would film him in jail and leaving jail, and then he would say, well, and I don't want you in my life anymore. I want to go and live my freedom. Mm. So the idea was to give him the camera for him to either film his freedom or not return the camera. That would provide the ending towards the film.
Když mi René psal, že kamera je v háji a natočil jenom porno, tak zároveň v tom samém vzkazu napsal a chci 4 lístky na premiéru a jako toho filmu svýho. A přišel tam s přítelkyní, bratrem, se psem a všecko bylo zapomenuto. Kamera byla zapomenuta a začali jsme novou spolupráci.
And when René writes me the message that the camera is gone, that all he ever shot was porn on it, in the same text message, he asked for 4 tickets for the opening night of his film. And he showed up with his girlfriend, his brother, his dog, and everything was forgotten. The camera was forgotten, and we opened a new chapter in our relationship and started shooting.
Já jsem mu akorát říkala, že podělal si to sám, mohl si mít lepší konec, když by si ho natočil sám, tak by to bylo pravděpodobně lepší než to, co jsem udělala já, ale a on řekl, no jo, no, to je život.
I just told him that he screwed up because he could have had a better ending, that if he made an end, that it would have been a better ending than the one I provided. And
right.
He said, well, whatever, that's life.
No, a, takže točíme s ním dále a za tu dobu tedy byl René ve vězení jenom jednou. A to za řízení bez řidičáku. A protože je recidivista, tak je takováhle blbost, jako už za to jde do vězení, byl tam asi rok.
So we keep shooting with him, and actually during that time he has only been in jail for like once for a really petty offense for driving without a license. Mm-hmm. But since he is an offender, he's been to jail many times. Even such a small offense can result in a 1-year sentence. He was in jail for a year.
Jinak za tu dobu vystřídal tady několik žen, většinou krásný, chytrý a zajímavý. Vystřídal několik zaměstnání, vždycky na černo, přemá velký dluhy. Provozoval rockový klub. A teď pracuje ve sběrných surovinách, kde je docela slušně placený, a taky je to na černo.
And in the years since the film, since we've been shooting again, he's had several beautiful, intelligent and interesting girlfriends.
Of course
he's had,
he does.
Several jobs. He always works illegally because he has formidable debts, so he doesn't work legally, but he used to run a rock club, and now he works in a scrapyard, again illegally, but the pay is quite nice.
Našel se jeho syn, o kterém se není jistý, jestli je to jeho syn, ale možná, že jo, o kterém se v prvním filmu mluví. Dostal syfilis. Zjistilo se, že jedna z těch žen, s kterou byl, vlastně není žena, ale muž, takže takovýhle dobrodružství.
His son resurfaced, who may not actually be his son, but might be his son, so he reappeared, he's mentioned in the first film. Also, he got syphilis, he contracted syphilis, and one of the girlfriends turned out not to be a woman, but a man, so... Many adventures.
Not a dull life. This man does not lead a dull life.
A jenom taková scéna na té premiéře. Jeho přišel novinář dělat s Renem interview. Sedli si na pohovku a vedle seděl Reného pes, který v průběhu toho interview sežral tomu novináři papír s otázkama. A tak jsem si řekla, to je možná taková metafora toho nechat život plynout, nemít otázky napsané na papíře a nechat se inspirovat životem.
And there was a scene at the opening of the first film when a journalist wanted to interview René. They were sitting on a sofa. The journalist had a list of questions and René's dog ate that sheet of paper with the questions. And I thought perhaps this was a metaphor that one should let life take its course and not have a set of questions written down and perhaps be inspired by life.
Exactly. Which leads me to Mallory, a woman that we mentioned in the beginning, who you filmed with and followed for 13 years. And after, I mean, there have been a couple of times where I've actually watched all three films back to back. And of course, after watching René and Katka, life just seems unbearable. And then comes this woman who from the outside looks the same, a drug addict, on the down and out, you know, and we feel like, oh my goodness, like, here we go again. This is not gonna end well, and we're gonna have to sit through this other tragedy. But this woman prevails over and over and over again. I mean, to me, she is a true heroine, not the drug heroine, but a hero. Because despite her circumstances, which are very rough indeed, she stays the course. She is a person that has, and we don't know, it's a mystery. What does she have that Katka is missing to enable her to stay strong and never go back to drugs, no matter how bad her life gets? And I'm wondering, was your relationship with her different somehow when you kind of learned how resilient this woman is and how determined she was to stay clean, no matter what?
Mallory je ideální postava pro dokumentární film. Je absolutně otevřená, upřímná, nic nezakrývá a skvěle mluví.
Mallory is an ideal protagonist for a documentary filmmaker, for a documentary film, because she's absolutely open, she's absolutely sincere, and she's also well-spoken. Mm-hmm.
Takže od prvního momentu, kdy jsem ji viděla, jsem si říkala, to je skvělý typ. A za dobu natáčení se tohle nezměnilo, ale mnohokrát mě příšerně naštvala, protože dovede být nespolehlivá a občas lže, kecá. Ale vždycky prostě se to potom zase vrátilo, takže ten vztah je vlastně pořád jako se všema výkyvama nahoru a dolů jsme pořád v kontaktu.
So when I first met her, I thought she was a great character, and that obviously never changed, but over time she has managed to annoy me many times because she would be unreliable. She would lie about things, she would bullshit her way around, and then she would come back. So our relationship has had its ups and downs, mm-hmm. but it's a strong relationship nevertheless.
A teď pokračujeme v natáčení, teda Mallory taky. A Mallory má teď novou aktivitu. A sice stala se mluvčí iniciativy, která se jmenuje Svoboda hospodám. Chtějí docílit toho, aby se smělo v určitých typech hospod kouřit, což bylo zakázané, a Mallory to nemůže snést.
So we've continued shooting with her, and she has a new activity because she's become the face or spokesperson for an initiative titled Freedom to the Pubs. And she wants to make sure that smoking is allowed in a certain types of pubs, because we had a smoking ban and she's struggling with it. She can't bear it. So.
A jako chodí do parlamentu přesvědčovat poslance o tom, že by se měl změnit zákon, mluví v senátu, jako opravdu mluví na různých manifestacích, jako na Václavském náměstí velká manifestace, kde Mallory stojí na pódiu a hřímá k davům. Takže jako trošku mi připomíná takovou tu slavnou malbu od Delacroix, Svoboda vedoucí lid na barikády, a tak to je Mallory, a na tom praporu má napsáno Svobodu hospodám.
So she's actually addressed the Senate, she's addressed the Parliament about the smoking ban, about the law being changed, and she's actually spoken at large demonstrations in Wenceslas Square in the center of Prague. You know, she addressed the crowds like that, like in the Delacroix painting, freedom leading the crowds to the barricades. So mm-hmm. that's her, that's Mallory with the big flag, and the flag says freedom to the pubs.
Mm. Interesting.
It's a good idea.
Good cause. Good cause. So we're almost out of time, but this is just a curious question. I mean, you're obviously very, very well known in Czech Republic. I mean, are people in that society, I mean, do you get letters and requests or to say, oh, I know this person, he or she would make a good protagonist, or, I mean, are you constantly inundated with ideas now from the public for you?
Ano, velmi často přichází nápady a ideje, co bych měla natočit, ale já vždycky omluvně píšu, že bohužel nemám dost energie, kapacity a sil rozjíždět nějaký nový projekty a předávám to kamarádce, novinářce, která něco z těch případů zpracuje občas.
Yeah, I get many ideas like that, but I always have to apologize that I just don't have enough energy to set out on another project. Mm-hmm. But I give these ideas to a friend of mine who's a journalist, and often she will go and pursue the story.
Okay.
Takže je to zajímavé, že vás to napadlo, že to je fakt velice častá situace a já, i když některé ty příběhy mě připadají úplně mimo, tak nějak cítím takovou odpovědnost k těm lidem, že mi napíšou, že prostě to nějak něco s tím dělám a řeším to, a to mi vlastně bere v poslední době docela dost času. No.
It's interesting that you ask, because I keep getting a lot of these letters, and even though some of the ideas are completely out there and some of them are really wild, still I feel this responsibility to somehow address these ideas or these issues, and lately it's been taken up quite a lot of time.
A ještě jedna věc k tomu, že já vlastně taková moje celoživotní touha byla být nenápadná, a což se teď v poslední době ne úplně vždycky daří. No.
You know, I've always wanted to be inconspicuous all my life, and lately I've not been very successful at that.
Well, especially this week.
Yes, this week, probably yes. It's interesting experience.
Yes. Well, we have to end. We have a reel to show of, again, as I mentioned in the very beginning, the retrospective films here at IDFA, as well as all of your top 10 selections. So to close, we will play that now. Was I right about that? Do we have this information? Maybe I made a mistake.
So I can in between.
Here we are. Okay. Oh, so it's a graphic, not. So, the dates and of all the top 10 films and the retrospective, some of which have already played. But I would really encourage you to check out as many of these as possible. It's a really beautiful history of Czechoslovakia, Czech Republic, and the filmmakers, the wonderful filmmakers, you know, along the way that have inspired you. And again, it's a wonderful selection. So,
and
so thank you very much for your attention this afternoon. And thank you so much, Helena, for your presence here with us. It's been a pleasure.
So So thank you for your interest, because for me it's a great pleasure to be here, because I think that it is the best documentary film festival, and so such an honor for me to be here, all my colleagues and inviting me to be here.
Mm-hmm. Really? Well, it's an it's an honor to celebrate your yes. your work, yes. truly,
and
truly.
So what's the most important that I hope that viewers can could enjoy this film and something to know something from Czech Republic. Thank you.
Thank you.